So today I'm talking to Hayo Renders.
Very good.
Who's kindly agreed to talk to me. He's here today in Nagoya at the Wireless Ready conference and talking about gaming and language learning. So before we talk about other things, I'd like to go back to your presentation today.
Sure.
Could you recap for us, for the listeners and watchers, about the PhD research that you were involved in?
Yeah, that's not my own research. That's one of my PhD students, Sorada Watana from Thailand, who's doing her PhD at the University of Canterbury in New Zealand. She's doing a very interesting study where she's looking at the effects of gameplay on L2 interaction, specifically looking at the effects on the quantity and quality of L2 interaction. And so, for example, we're looking at the logs of the audio and chat interaction in the game, and then investigating things like, you know, what discourse functions appear within these transcripts. For example, what are what's the number of turns, what is the average length of each turn, and then compare this between different conditions. And secondly, also, as I mentioned during the talk, looking at the effects of gameplay on willingness to communicate. And of course, this is a very important concept, because you can be interested in language learning, but if you're not actually willing to try and make mistakes, perhaps, and you know, take some risks in the language, in other words, if you're not willing to produce the language, create output, then you will probably have fewer opportunities to develop yourself. So if gameplay has an effect on this, then that could be a very potentially very beneficial part of playing computer games.
You were fortunate enough to be able to adapt the existing role-playing game, right, to make the tasks more relevant for the learners.
That's right. So what Sorada did was look at the interface that you get when you play the game, and then adjust the instructions that appear within the game. So we were then able to get her to write quests, similar to web quests, but then for use within the gaming environment, in such a way that the quest would be meaningful for language interaction and language learning, and then have different quests, and then investigate if these had different effects on the way that the students interacted within the game.
You mentioned at the beginning of your talk, you were talking about things like DS games and online games and other existing language learning games, specifically for language learning. Some of it is, a lot of it's a little bit disappointing, right?
Yeah, a lot of it is very disappointing indeed. And I realized later as I walked out of the room that several members of the audience were actually publishers themselves. And I just shown all these examples of bad games. But yeah, it is very disappointing. There's very little pedagogy in there, or at least it may be pedagogically sound in a way, but it's not making use of the affordances that are available within the gaming environment. And I've always wondered about this, because developing your own game, obviously, even for a large publisher, would be a very, very expensive undertaking. But like this study that my PhD student and I are doing shows, it only takes just really a couple of people, and they can then themselves adjust an existing game rather than create an entirely new one, and make it suitable for the purposes of learning and teaching languages.
Well, that was another thing you mentioned in your conclusion, which I thought was really a very good point, about we should try and use existing games, and you said that applied linguistics shouldn't mess around with game design.
Yeah, you know, if your toilet's broken, you ring a plumber, you know. You ring a professional to do whatever job needs doing, and applied linguists, we're not game designers, we're not software designers, we're not interface specialists. Let us deal with the pedagogy, let us do the curriculum design, etc. But let's leave that part of it to the game designers. Because you can see from all the examples that we looked at during the presentation today that if you don't, then the results are really very disappointing. And imagine if you're a student, if you're, I don't know, a 17-year-old kid, and you're used to playing all sorts of very interesting, highly interactive, engaging games, and then there's this teacher says, look, I've made this myself, and there's this 2D sort of completely boring so-called game. I mean, how is that going to interest you? Yeah. How is that going to motivate you?
Yeah, you might as well just stick with the paper flashcards.
Yes, indeed,
Mentioned a few statistics, and of course I know that this particular project was with Thai learners, but a lot of the statistics that mentioned, and a lot of the statistics that I find are based on research in the United States.
True.
And of course, it's fascinating. There were things like, you know, a 21-year-old in the US would read for 5,000 hours but spend 10,000 hours on a cell phone, and so on.
Yeah.
And later on, you mentioned that 42% of game players in the US are women. And they are very interesting. Do you think they are... We can extrapolate these points globally. Do you think this...
I think there will be market differences between different countries, different cultures. Maybe, perhaps not even on the surface, perhaps in terms of the number of male versus female players, but certainly in the types of games that learners play, or the types of games that female learners play in Japan as opposed to male learners in Germany or wherever. And I think it's important. We just don't have enough research. As you say, a lot of it comes from the US. A lot of it is quite sort of US-centric. It's important that we investigate different game practices in different cultures and different settings, not just cultures, but also at home, in school, and in other environments. And until we get more data, until we better understand why people play games, how they play games, how they interact with games, what kinds of games work for certain types of learners and not for other learners, adult learners versus younger learners, etc., it's really hard to make any pedagogically meaningful decisions on how you're going to design a game. And that's a pity, because there is so incredibly much potential, I think, in them for all groups, for all cultures, males and females and ages.
So where did this initial interest in games come from? Why did you decide to start looking into this area?
Well, one of my main interests over the last few years has always been in the area of out-of-class learning. Anything to do with learner autonomy, anything really that can help us to encourage learners to interact with the language outside of the institution, outside of the school, outside of the classroom, and also to prepare learners for being able to do that. So autonomy comes into that, of course, but also using technology, any kind of technology that will hopefully encourage learners to continue and try out what they've learned in class, but then put it into practice, because without that, what are we talking about? And I realized, like here in Japan, obviously English is a foreign language, and it's hard to encourage learners to go out and find opportunities to use the language in a meaningful way. But games and other technologies do actually offer that opportunity. But without showing learners how to make best use of it, it's unlikely that learners will know what to do with it and will enjoy it. And I think there's a lot of potential there to draw on these kinds of environments and bring them into the classroom, and then prepare learners to be able to take them outside the classroom and then continue to learn with them.
You mentioned that you were interested especially in learner autonomy and things like this for some time. And I know you've done a lot of work with self-access centres. Do you think we need self-access centres anymore? Do you think we can just go virtual?
It's very interesting that you mentioned it. I mean, a self-access centre can be virtual, can be physical. So there's two questions here. One, should a self-access centre be a physical centre, or should it be online? A more interesting question to my mind is, do we need self-access at all? And I've just finished writing an article that's called The End of Self-Access.
Okay.
But then between brackets it says, as we know it.
Okay.
Right? So I do actually question at the moment the usefulness of self-access.